Let's just get this thing going.
I'm gonna move this closer to you because it's got the mic on it. Okay. Or, actually, let me get the hockey puck.
I don't know, we're gonna try to come up with some kind of thing where I'm not in critical path.
Nice.
I'm boggled down. All right. Parker is online. Parker, can you hear us? Send us if you can.
He's got mic sound.
I got weird sound.
This thing's cool.
Yeah?
Sorry. I can hear you.
Sweet. Okay. We will endeavor to slowly. So, I think the question was really, where do we want to start with this? We're trying to educate people as to kind of how to go about this. I am going to go home tonight, and I thought I was going to grab it this weekend, but I just didn't. I forgot. I will get the full manual, and there's a full manual that I think that they took away that had like a lot more information. When I went and looked at it before, they said, this is the dumbed down version. If you need help, contact us. But I have the Uber version from before. And so I will get that and try to send that out. But in terms of what are we trying to accomplish like right now, are we trying to say, here's how to do various things? Or are we just trying to like, do we want to start up a dumbed down version of the Cube satellite and try to run that? Or do we want to just go for broke and try to do try to close out the Uber version that we have here.
Is that a non-rhetorical question?
No, this is non-rhetorical.
I think we want to figure out what's making the weird time stuff
okay. In
the simple model.
Sure.
Because even the simple model is going to be a huge level of detail up from analytical.
Okay.
And then ideally we could make it so that with the simple model, we could just swap in the more complicated models or the more complicated parts.
So here's what I'm going to do then. If we want to do that first to try to like flesh it out, I'm not going to worry about this. I did push this model in its current form to the Morsat Thermal Master. And so now this is the updated version in the master branch. So if you need to download that, then you can pull from that. But I will switch to, I think there's another one on there called Sputnik 2.0. And we can, this is my model from back in the day. So basically, you know, training wheel style where, this thing is going to run a bit slow, I would imagine, but in this model it's already got the finite element meshes assigned to it, and I have basically temperature sensors at 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 11 points. So there's 3 card slots in the middle. And then there's 2 on either side, kind of simulating where the solar planes are, and then 1 on each end. So, with that, I'm sure my wife wasn't calling. So with that,
and the 11 is like smack in the center.
There's 3 smack in the center. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, and then if we rotate.
Oh, you just have them on 2 sides because.
I have them on all 4 sides, and then I have one on each. You can kind of make out each. See how you make out like the 3 interstitial planes there. So I was reading temperature for graphing purposes off of those 11 points. That's what the triangles are indicative of. So if I remember not to hit health in the state.
Um,
Now, if I go through here, I feel like I feel like this is where. Oh, I did turn it off. So, let's do this really fast. Joe, you and I have got been through this before where it's just really painful.
Yeah.
So, we'll let that update. It's going to get rid of everybody. Alright. Then, back down here. We're going to build ourselves a new set. Sound effects. So, for this model, just so that everybody's aware, you look edge on. Basically tried to put I tried to put a rail on each side, and then I put two back planes, and I define these as FR4. So anything that, so these two rails here, I defined as aluminum 6061, and I just, you know, Google searched, give me the material set for this, with the CTE and everything. So, you'll have to bear with me as we try to, like, work through this really fast, but if I remember correctly, we can go to...
Hey Parker, I'm gonna mute you for a little bit. Or can you mute yourself?
We've decided to make it for just for this.
Thanks.
Alright, so what I have here is you can define a bunch of different stuff in here. Joe and I had already previously covered that we can do orbits. That is probably going to be one of the bigger things that we're going to want to try to tackle. So I'll kind of spend more of tonight on that, I think. But I just really quickly wanted to take you guys to thermophysical properties. So that's where I believe this is where we are going to go ahead and define. And you can do optical properties as well. So reflections and that kind of thing. But if I go into thermal physical, then I went through and I defined in our model here, aluminum, a black body, and I think I did this as just like a sample when I was trying to run like different simulations, and I just had defined like a black body of perfect absorption and everything. Boards is quote unquote FR4, and so that's, I just Google searched and was like, okay, give me an emissivity of like 0.7, and then we have, you know, a bunch of other stuff in here. All of this could be entirely wrong, but for the sake of just running another model here and trying to figure out why we're getting goofy results, we can keep this the same. Solar panels, I did these just as like I think I even looked up, like, I think we knew at that point that we were going with the Alta devices, so I think I tried to look up stuff that was closest to what they had that I could find, like, so like gas, solar panels.
So it only gives you emissivity, it doesn't give you like solar albedo?
I think you can do that with optical. So solar albedo, do you mean like reflectivity?
Yeah.
So yeah, I think you can do that with the optical properties. But you can define all manner of things in here, right? I can even set a color. So if I set a color for a solar panel, I'm going to make those blue. I don't think it matters. I don't think it did anything for me. I was, it kind of made it angry. And then I took out a density for what I thought the solar panels were going to be, an effective emissivity, and just tried to plug in the very basic materials. I didn't dive too much into laminate or aggregate property sets. I was really just like, give me a dumb block. Mm-hmm. So, to answer your question really fast, Joe, I did define optical and thermal physical properties. I was trying to remember this. So in here, that's where you get your absorptivity, your transmissivity, and all of the fun stuff. So once again, Parker, I don't know if you've ever used Autodesk, so or Thermal Desktop, but in case you're not familiar, and please like interrupt me if I'm going too fast or something. Like, feel free to IM us and tell me to shut the hell up and go back and explain something better. So Thermal Desktop is the plugin for CindaFluent, right? Okay, sounds good. So Thermal Desktop is it is the plugin for CindaFluent.
That's absolutely
and so
terrifying.
As part of that, normally you get like windows that are up to like, you know, here or something like that. You get like normal windows. With Thermal Desktop, they give you these cool new windows, and that's where you start getting into this other stuff. So if there's ever anything that you need to do that is Thermal Desktop specific, you can look under Thermal or TD Mesher. The TD Mesher is going to be it's a Thermal Desktop finite element mesh creator. And that's where I, you know, actually, is that going to work? Oh, I'll be so angry. Oh my God, it worked. Dang it, Joe. All right. See, I'm learning new things every day.
I'm guessing you spent a lot of time meshing stuff.
No. That was me. Remember clicking the light bulbs on and off? It has a button where you can turn them all off or turn them all on. So this is the mesh that you're seeing here. It does this a lot too, so you have to be really careful and gentle with it. Otherwise it gets angry. But this is the satellite. Each one of those dot looking things is a node. It's where it's gonna essentially read a difference in temperature, and then it's gonna map a gradient between them.
What was that hotkey you just hit?
I just hit escape, but to turn them all off or on, under TD Mesher, all on or all off. So if we go all off, and then we wait 4 minutes. Then. Oh, it turned off my actual stupid things. Well, that sucks. Hang on. Is it going to... Now I'm just learning. Nice. All right, for the win. So these two areas are really where you want to live in terms of trying to look at things. I didn't play around a lot with the mesher. I knew just enough to like create a mesh and then to basically run the part, right? So I basically had whenever I needed to make changes, I had like a dumped down version that didn't have a mesh on it. And then I would take that and make a change and then save a new copy and then remesh, because I didn't know how to undo the mesh. So, that being said, this is kind of where you're going to live, right? So there's a bunch of stuff in here that I don't really understand, but the thermal, physical, and the optical properties is where we assign all of those material sets. And that's going to define a large portion of it. I found out that by changing like the absorptivity and emissivity by like 0.15 either way, it made a pretty significant difference in terms of what your model outputs. So back to the thing that I think we should probably spend the most time on, because that was one of the things that you guys rightly pointed out in my other simulations, was the weird time signatures. So over here under orbit, or even under the thermal desktop, and then I think you can go to orbit here. There's a drop down, and we can do edit the current orbit, manage all of our orbits, and then you can do orbit display preferences. So this actually has a built-in orbit solver for us. And so you just tell it the type of orbit. So we'll edit our current orbit. So this right now, the type of orbit that I have built in here is 400 kilometers in altitude and a inclination or a beta angle of 75 degrees. So 75 degrees, if I remember correctly, is about what the ISS flies at, or something like that. It's like one of the max beta angles or inclinations that the ISS flies at.
Someone said chocolate milk.
So you can run through this, and this gives us different variations upon what we want to do. So this In this case, this should have a y-axis spin. So I'm breaking Joe's cardinal law, and this is defined as the y-axis when nominally we call that the z-axis for all of our other intents and purposes. When we redo the model, we did redo it with this being the z-axis, but for mine, I was a bad engineer.
I mean, to be fair, I don't think we'd figured out what the actual axes were called at that point.
No, it's true, but still. So, all that to say that our pointing axis we want to have as the z plus n cap, which is this guy. And then you can tell it where you want that to point. So you can say the nadir, which is essentially the center point of the Earth in the orbital plane of, like, with the sun, right? You can say point towards the sun, point towards a random star, and then you have to give it a right ascension and a declination, or in the velocity vector. So in the area that it's traveling, which is always just going to be like orbital path, essentially. You can also put an additional constraint here, and this is where I said, so we want the z plus n cap, and I said we want z plus to be pointing, so in my case, z plus is up, right? And I said point towards the velocity vector, so I want the long side pointing essentially in the orbital path, and then the additional constraint I imposed was y-axis pointing at the nadir. And I thought, oh, and then I, under fast spin, which is, so I was at orientation, if I go to fast spin, then I can generate a rotationally average heating for vehicle spinning about an input vector. And I told it to spin about the y with a rotation of 1, essentially, RPM. Which I don't know that we ever, I don't know that there was ever units that I found for what that spin is. So I could be saying like one rotation per year, one rotation per, you know, decade, unsure. But is this axis centered around the satellite for fast spin? Yes, it would be centered. It would be centered along the y-axis. So in this case, the n cap.
I mean, it's the direction that the solar radiation is hitting the satellite. Right.
No, it would be.
All this controls is the direction that's hitting the satellite. So
yes,
we don't really care where the center of rotation is.
Yeah, we don't care. Well, I do care where the center of rotation is, because if it's not like in the middle, right? So if it's not rotating around this, then it could be wobbling. And in this case, I was trying to model our rotisserie chicken style rotation. Is that what you're saying? I'm not sure that I quite understood your question.
I think so. Because, I mean, I want to get the thing.
Sorry, Joe is grabbing props so that he can educate me properly.
I suspect we have the same picture in our minds, but I'm just being silly.
No, this is good.
So the way we expect it to rotate is like around the center like that.
Exactly.
Right. But if it, for example, rotated, how can I do this? If it rotated around one of the rails.
Oh, for example, okay. I see what you're saying.
It'd
yeah.
be silly, but it wouldn't really make a difference for the thermal model.
It might, though, right? Because I think it would affect your RPMs, but ultimately I don't know that it would make that big of a difference.
Because it's only giving you control over rate of rotation, right? It's not giving you control over angular momentum.
Right, yeah.
So I don't think it would change the RPM.
Well, no, I don't mean RPM so much as I... Well, I guess that is what I... Because even if it's here, and it's trucking...
Turn the camera back on.
Sorry, I'm processing. So if it's here, the end cap would still stay the same. No, I think you're right. I don't think that it matters. Yeah. No, I think you've got me convinced. Yeah.
But I mean, it probably goes around like the center of mass.
Right. I mean, that's what
the
I would.
The same thing to do.
Right. As soon as we get to space, we don't start defying physics and whatnot. So, all that to say that this is how I controlled spin. And so I basically created three different cases for this, both at a 75 degree beta angle and then at a 0 degree beta angle. And those are those stupid graphs that I have that are wonky. I did a y-axis spin, and then I did a hot spin, which was just, you know, dead stick, wasn't spinning at all, trying to simulate that, like, if, you know, we wouldn't even have control over it. It was just kind of orbiting in space, to where it, like, wasn't moving.
The only thing is, though,
and it would be like, I guess it'd be indicative of, like, if our reaction wheels just got stuck spinning and we could never unstick them so that it just wouldn't tumble. Like in conjunction with the back of torquers or something like that, right? To where it's like literally just holding it, like not moving. And then there's the what I call tumbling mode. And that's actually what I saw with the models, was that tumbling was the best. And so for tumbling, what I did was under orientation, or actually under fast spin, I think I did 1, 1, and 1. And that just basically, it's like spinning end over end, just kind of doing its own thing.
Yeah. I mean, I think that would actually be different than tumbling.
Oh, I agree. But I don't know how to randomly generate the tumbling. I'm sure that we could figure out a way.
Well,
but
one thing we could do, because the way, where in the camera, the way tumbling would actually work, let's say, this is clearly going to be the minor axis, mm-hmm. right? This is going to be the lowest angular momentum. And the highest angular momentum is going to be one of these axes. And I don't know which one that is off the top of my head. But the intermediate one, if we're spinning around the intermediate one, we'll do that, you know, screwdriver in space thing or wrench in space thing where
right.
it spins and then, like, flips and spins.
Yeah.
So we could just do one case of modeling it in one direction and then be like, okay, well, it'll just flip.
Oh, okay.
So we could model it in one direction, and I don't know if you can do this in Thermal Desktop, but take the end conditions from that and then input it as the starting conditions for a satellite that's flipped around.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that we can define the starting conditions to be whatever we want. So, trying to think how did I do that before? I'll have to think about that one, but don't let me forget about that, because I defined the starting conditions as being room temp, assuming I got kicked out of the door of the ISS, which may not be entirely realistic, but that's why we started up so high, and then the graphs tend to like drop off pretty quick.
I mean, it's probably pretty close relative to being in space.
Yeah, I think it just depends on what the Japanese module, like what the NanoRax launcher, is it exposed to space? It's not airtight.
Right.
Or I guess it would have to be.
I don't think it would be airtight, but it might be like painted white or something. I would imagine it would be not unreasonable for it to be sitting on the robot arm for hours before it actually gets deployed.
Well, because it's not in the robot arm. They it's like a potato cannon, to where like there's the Japanese module, the JAXA module, and they like pull the dock in, and then they seal, and then I think that they like thunk and load it, and then they like close the door and then push it back out, don't they? Or is it actually on the arm where it just like holds it out and then potato cans it out? I'm not sure.
There's videos of it.
There's videos. There's cool videos. So definitely something we'll have to look into.
The goal is to control the panel. What I've been trying to do is do that via controlling the current.
I think I understand maybe what the issue was in talking about it right now. So if you look at this, there's a block on here for positions. And so there's use equal increments. start, and so
yeah,
what this is it's kind of puts the number of positions that it essentially in the orbit that it takes measurements at, and you define that number. So here, because I didn't want a crazy long list, I said, give me 20 increments, and from 0 to 360. Right? So there's
so it's a pretty sparse sample.
It's kind of a pretty sparse sample. So I'm wondering if we increase this to be something much higher, if that would smooth out those graphs.
Yeah.
But it doesn't explain the peaks.
What do you mean?
Well, because in some of the graphs they like come back up to where it like pinks and then like comes back down. So let me,
I mean, it might if it's an aliasing thing.
I'm trying to figure out a way.
True. To... Sorry, I'm pulling up the.
It's 80 volts. The LED cannot be solid.
Is this it? Or is this the video?
Ideally, at least.
No, that's not it.
Can't use the digital connection on Earth. Too high of voltage.
Where is the Orsa?
Considering PWM, but I don't have PWM interrupt.
Oh, yeah, no, I'm pretty sure it is.
Well, it turns on
and off. I don't know how the solar panels.
Okay.
The solar panels give you a voltage and stop giving voltage. Yeah.
Right.
So,
and even though it's the same net flux over.
No, you can't do that.
It's not this one. That one still drops.
Well, that one, you can really see how big the. The time between samples is relative to the relative to the signal.
You have your
yeah. Yeah, I really don't know. I'm not sure. I'm not sure why I didn't catch this whenever I went through the first time.
I think we should just try setting it to like 1 degree increments and see what happens.
And just see if it smooths it out?
Yeah.
All right. All right, so we can try, we can do that. So we can do, so in that case it'll be 360.
That's all your hair.
All right. Are you?
Well, I mean, we can see it's going. Oh, because that's if you wanted to like manually tweak it, right?
Oh yeah. You're right. So we're gonna give it that. Shadow crossings automatically include entry always in the sun, exit always in the sun. Position angles true anomaly and mean anomaly. Yeah, you should know what those meant, but it's basically like. I don't even know
what the actual angle is and what's the average angle of the orbit.
It could be. Planetary data. This right here is Earth, and you can set whichever one you want. So when we do go to try to take over Jupiter, we'll simulate this pretty easily. Oh, not Mars. Not Mars yet.
Jupiter first.
Flux, I use 1354 watts per meter squared, which is what I found online to be the generally recognized solar insulation. Even though, weirdly enough, I've always heard 1370 for the surface of the planet, which doesn't make sense to me. But I like looked this up because I was really confused. And 1354 was like, people had used that before. So maybe they've never been to space and actually gotten a sunburn,
yeah,
but albedo 0.35 is also generally recognized. Albedo I've always heard as 0.31 to 0.35, so I decided for worst case scenario of albedo from planet Earth, which would be the highest reflectivity. We can do it versus time or versus latitude and longitude, which is insanity, and I don't think we would ever need that kind of like detail.
Yeah,
but we have that option, you know, in case you're like, hey, what happens if it passes overhead and it pours rain? 1362. From COPG and the geophysical research. Wait, for, you mean for insulation? Yeah. I'm down to go 1362. Let's ramp this up. IR Planet Shine. I don't remember where I got this one. I think this is another Google.
If I do work.
And then we can put in comments like, you know, holy crap, this is going to hurt. So with that, do we have a beta angle? Do we want to keep it at 75 just for the sake of kind of being where we're at?
I mean, that's the beta angle for the ISS, right?
I think so.
It's almost identical, but it's not.
Yeah. Well, as high as 75 degrees and as low as negative 75 degrees. Right, because beta angle is a combination of the inclination with the tilt of the Earth.
That sounds right.
Because so it's based off like the nadir, is what it's based off of. So, well, let's just keep 75. We can do that.
Thinks for a while.
It does like to think for a while. So what it's probably doing right now is trying to create the 300 some odd points that weren't there before. Oh, hey, cool. So this is an orbital view. And, oh, stop that.
Okay, get up. I'm going, boom. I'm sorry.
So there's the satellite. So this is really cool, but it's also more or less useless.
It's just a cute little visualization.
It is a cool visualization. Makes it easy to use on projects / bog down your AutoCAD. This is the downfall of this particular software.
Oh, does it like draw a mesh for every position?
I don't think so. But here I think it just simulates. There we go. All right, don't touch anything. So this is simulating, once again, the nadir of the Earth in relation to the Sun. And then you have the shadow, which is what that purple cone is. And then the yellow is our orbital path. So if we were to change this, it'll, you know, change that orbital path. Let's make sure that that saves. Okay. So you can go in here and you can create a bunch of orbits, right? And then you can display each a bunch of different ones and tell it to do a bunch of cool or stupid stuff. So once again, that's this button right here. It says manage orbits. There we go.
I didn't want to log into anything. Then imported it. I log in from here once I have.
But if you want to like go back to that orbital view, you can click on orbit display and preferences, and then you can view vehicle set, orbit positions. Like, so if you want to sit there and you want to like cycle through all of them, you can use those buttons and that'll work through them. With that, I still feel like there's something else I'm forgetting.
We have something big planned for my episode
two.
What is it? Brian.
So we went crazy. We're
so whenever we go to do the post processing, that's where you come here. So we'll run that. I will see if I can try to get away. Wait, we're not meeting on Friday because you guys are planning on doing the launch. So maybe next Tuesday night if I'm available. I may be at work till late, but I will try to sneak back out, and maybe we can try to do some post-processing. Because I'm assuming we want to kick this off tonight. Is that if we can go?
Yeah, how long will it take to simulate stuff?
Tuesday night is supposed to 8 p.m. Friday's work. Okay. So potentially I could do this Friday, but I know that people are trying to get out for the rocket launch. Typically on my computer, when I hit go, it was a don't touch it and come back the next day, like 12 hours. With this thing's got a little bit more souped up RAM and some souped up graphics cards and stuff like that. We might be able to squeeze it out faster, but I don't know by how much. Never run on this guy before. Mine, it was like a, you know, hey, honey, you don't need the computer for the next day and a half, right? And then she was like, why? And I was like, because I have homework.
Will it report how long it took in real time?
I think it will give us an estimate, potentially.
Okay. It'd be neat if we could time how long it took with, like, the with 4 increments, and then extrapolate that to how long it would take for 360 increments.
Well, and that's also based on keeping the mesh the way it is right now, and I think one of the things that you and I had talked about was can we go through whenever we set up the Uber model later and try to, like, actually set nodes, because I auto-meshed this one, and so I just hit, like, a create finite element mesh, but I think there's a way to go in here and to actively put in, like, a node on a corner and this and that, and then tie things together, and I think that might be easier, and it gives us better resolution.
Yeah. Do you know about mesh convergence?
Okay. No.
So,
bye, guys.
I'm going to draw a diagram on.
See you, Hans.
See you soon.
So, basically, one thing you can do to, like, quantitatively say whether or not a mesh is good is you can make meshes of finer and finer cell sizes.
Okay.
And if you're auto meshing stuff, that's really easy to control because you set, you know, I want such and such average density.
Right.
And
that could be what I did, and I was just foolish enough to create that, like, a large mesh.
And so you have, like, oh, drawing with a trackpad. You have, like, number of cells, and you have some value that you care about. And you run simulations with tighter and tighter meshes, and eventually you can, like, build up a curve.
Right.
That'll have some sort of asymptote to it. And so you can say, well, if I've got a mesh that's so thin, I've got, you know, some not decay time, but decay number of cells.
Right.
And so I'm at, like, 95% converged at whatever mesh size, and so that's my mesh size.
Gotcha.
And so you.
I mean, I would definitely be down to, like, look at it. You can also, like, mesh coincident nodes and stuff like that are kind of on top of each other, I think. But we can also do radiation calculations, which is cool, and I never tried to do it. That is something we should do at some point.
Is radiation stuff not... Oh, you mean as in, like, cosmic rays?
I think both. I think you could probably figure out how to do both on here.
Because I would assume we're doing IR, invisible radiation.
we have it incoming, and yeah, and how much we're exporting. So yeah, I guess it would be the actual radiation.
But is this talking about like ionizing radiation?
I mean, that's true.
I have no idea. All I know is that it has this fun drop down over here. Okay. I did not get into it. All that to say,
I mean, it was saying stuff in units of rads, so I'm guessing it's
got to be ionizing. Yeah. These are all preferences. Okay. Now, if you'll bear with me for a while. How do you reach your user preferences? Oh, sorry, that's thermal, and then preferences. Yeah, thermal is really, that's your, it's like the best way to go, because this drop-down has all the things you need. So.
Is it like ceiling?
Nope, stop that. Don't push the button I pushed.
What's the button you pushed?
It's just edit. Really, you can push
Sorry
that.
To interrupt. Is there a mini USB I can plug my phone into to charge over here?
I think there might be a gray cable on the middle of the table over there. There's a gray braided cable somewhere.
Yeah, I think I remember it was like being over here once. This is
also. There's one connected to this Raspberry Pi right here that has done nothing for ages that you can use, I'm sure.
I found this one right here.
Do it.
So, with that said, if you go to Case Set Manager, this is how you run. Okay, so I'm going to go back. Thermal. Case Set Manager. It's a big green button, which makes it helpful. And then you can say, which ones do you want to run? And I think you can turn these off. So, run one selected case. You can highlight multiple at the same time. I was only ever running one because I couldn't figure out. I wasn't very good with the post-processing, and I was trying to just do it piecemeal. So I just ran it one at a time. So for this one, I'm assuming that we're just going to run the Y spin, which is what we've been editing. And then that's right. So then in order to edit so that we can get our parameters, you go into edit, and then you're going to tell it what to calculate. So I calculated radiation. It's going to spit out conditions and a cap file. I didn't really ever get into these. It's going to build an input file, which we need. It's going to run the CINDA model. It's going to post-process the CINDA results. And then it's going to generate a log file for it. Execute mapping to stress. I don't know that I ever did that, but that would be interesting. And then transient. So this is how we figured out how to do it over. This is how I thought that I was doing it over time. So we're saying, I don't want you to do it like at a certain point in orbit. I'm just saying, give me the transients of like over this amount of time from 0 seconds to whatever this time period is. So, I mean, we can keep that. I think that that is, I think it's 2 months.
Oh, shit. It's already 940.
Yeah. 3600? I think that's right. So, 604 divided by 60 divided by 60 is, oh wait, yeah, so that it's 168 hours, so it's a week. Let's make sure I did that right. 60 seconds times 60 seconds is 3600 times 24 is 86 times 7 is 600, yeah. So this one is currently set to record the amount of time over 1 week. You could also do parametric steady state at each orbit time position. So I was just keeping the transient. I don't know how you guys feel about it.
I mean, some of them were you know, clearly not at steady state yet. I almost wonder if we want to run a transient version and run a steady state version. Because some of the cases wouldn't be something where we would be starting with kicked out of the ISS starting conditions, right? Like the...
I think we have a pretty good likelihood of doing that.
The nadir pointing. Like, we're not going to come out...
No, you're right, you're right.
And the barbecue roll is like, maybe, probably not.
Right. Yeah. So we want to do steady state. So this is just going to do it.
But I wonder if steady state is actually going to give us a time series.
I don't think it will give you a time series. I think it'll just tell you...
It's a circle of blood.
I think it'll just say, here's what the temperature will be across these faces at each orbital position, not based on temperature.
So it's basically giving us one orbit.
I wouldn't even say it's... Yeah, I mean, it's not even... Yeah, it's just going to say, at this point, with this amount of solar insulation hitting you from this angle and this, you can expect this piece to be at this temperature, more or less. It's not going to include, at least I wouldn't assume that it would include, the ramp coming out, right? I think this would be like down the road.
Sorry.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Yeah. It would be like a, this is how much you can experience at a given moment, in a given position.
Have you messed with the parametric conditions?
I don't think I did. We can look at it. I don't know what dynamic Cinda is. Oh, okay. So I think you can tell it what variable you want to like tweak with.
Yeah.
It's kind of how I'm reading that. As you agree. So that's actually cool. I had not messed with that before. So that would be cool to be able to do for beta angle and then get the whole damn curve.
Yeah, I mean, it'd also be nice if we could say, like, if the mean temperature is changing by less than 1% per orbit, then stop the simulation. Right.
If the mean temperature is changing by less than 1% per orbit. Oh,
basically asking, check if you're at steady state before you stop the simulation.
Once we go to asymptotic.
Yeah.
And
it's Calvin's.
What are you asking?
Oh, if you would emergency print those for us.
No, maybe. Do you think it's the material? Yeah, the printer that causes it to be so different?
Yes. Sorry, Joe is multitasking. Do you have opinions, Parker, on which direction we want to go? I mean, I'm kind of the opinion that we should just see what...
Only 20 hours a week.
Maybe do, like, the steady state as well. And then, like, as we get more sophisticated, we can start playing with parametrics and looking at whether or not it's going to work. I would agree with that. And also, I really do think that we're going to want to take my model and change it. Because the aluminum on my model is solid. It's like a solid sheet of aluminum, which is going to throw off your temperatures drastically.
Yeah.
So that's right. I think that, like, you know, these are both uploaded. So, Parker, do you want to do steady state with the transient? Because I'd like to see the transient. I think it's important to try to get a hold of why we are seeing those weird spikes that I just didn't catch in the last time. So I'm thinking...
It seems like it's not a big change to do a steady state simulation versus a transient simulation.
No. Yeah. Well, I mean...
Do you know what it does if you check both of those?
I think it'll output both. I think we just have to choose between them, like when we don't want to do post-processing, which I think we can do. I think it's fine. I did not... Convergence criteria, I didn't ever really play around with. Or maybe I did. I don't remember. I think is that it'll output both. So I think like we can run both at the same time.
Yeah.
But I reckon that we'll, you know, if it breaks it, then my name is Andrew or something like that.
I asked him. Said,
exactly. Whenever something goes wrong, just change your name to Andrew
also,
real quick.
But at least they're
so I think max steady state iterations. This controls how long it takes. I remember that. And I don't remember why. I think it's like how many iterations it does over a point or something like that.
I think that's what I was just asking if it did.
Yeah. I think so. And this is, honestly, the manual that I have, which is, I just read that thing and pushed buttons and broke things. It has that kind of information in it. So that's stuff that we can continue to play with.
Andrew.
Well, I figure we'll just keep it like that for now. I was able to run it. That's something we can play with if it keeps getting weird. I don't remember if I did anything with this. Heating rates. Yeah, I don't remember.
It's fine. You're gonna be doing a Linux based IO
application. Okay.
That sounds good. That's good.
Output.
You don't think it'd be
So these are all different nodes, I think, or different panels and whatnot. So I had it go to auto. So the increment that we want to do it, I think we just want like 1 second, right?
Sure.
Every 1 second.
Oh, well, so then what's the difference between that and the positions in the orbit?
I think that the positions in the orbit. Well, I'm not sure, actually. That's a good question. I think the positions in the orbit are when you want to do steady state, and then if you do transient, then you just tell it how many seconds, and it'll just do it along the orbit, right?
Yeah, I can't use digital potentiometer because it's too high voltage.
Right.
I asked
Steve. Yeah.
That would be worth finding out.
Yes. Something like that looks like that would work.
No.
No, why not?
And then so this is the other thing I have for the output for the color post-processing and the XY plots. I have it doing all for steady state and end of transient and then temperatures, but not incident heat, capacitance, conductors, or anything like that. We can hook it up. The register is when we start getting into the dynamic stuff. And I think that's where we can do the different, because it said that it would assign something as a register.
What does that mean?
For whenever we are going to do the parametric, I think that's where that comes into play. I think it assigns like a variable there.
Huh.
So like if I go back here, was it here? Yeah. So for parametric, click that. When I hit this, output as a Cinda register.
Oh.
So you would output this as a full-on register, and then.
So you could see what your parametric.
So you could see what the parametric was. So then, if I go back here and I say, put out my register, then it allows you to do the post-processing after the fact. Cinda, I did not ever touch this. Didn't do this either, but this is the dynamic Cinda. So this is actually that register.
Was he? That's what I said.
So that's more stuff that we'll have to get into. Set initial temperatures. Read from results.
Yes.
Optical properties.
Oh,
right. Awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
Good memory.
Anyway, sorry.
Wait a second.
Are we going to give the actual presentation?
No. I mean, we're just going to talk.
Hmm.
Yes, absolutely.
What is it?
It is the really good.
I'm not sure.
They said maybe if you send the files like to me.
Okay.
We just need three of these. The other one's okay.
Is this steals?
M's are really hard.
I imagine so.
Okay.
Alright.
Yes.
So I'm not sure what's going on with the properties. I thought that, I don't remember this, but I'm pretty sure that it will auto-load our TDP properties. So with that, I think we're good. And then I think that we can just hit run one selected case, and then unless there's any other questions or we need to like look at anything else really fast. I swear I was at one point I was able to say starting temperature was like X.
Those are sitting idle. Like let's get those done. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, it's TF.
Joe, do you agree? Is there anything that you want to look at still?
No, I don't think so.
All right. I did see that. Thank you for sending that over. I will try to take a look. But with that, I think we're just going to, well, let me check. Aha! I didn't hit OK. Always got to hit OK. This, that. OK. And here's where the pain begins. All right, so when it starts processing, it's you'll see this building oct tree down here.
Oh, I don't think they're going to be able to see that. How do I hide the little things? That sound. So that thing?
Yeah. All right. It fails element quality check.
Oh, so there's a really skewed element in there? Why would the auto generation do that?
Max skew is 0.99.
Ah, so we probably want something less than that.
I have no idea what max skew is.
I think that's how stretched out the tetrahedrons are.
So let's dial this back down to 0.75.
Got 2 points.
Yeah, I think.
What? 2.7?
Yeah.
Oh no, I said you had 2 points.
Oh, 2 points.
Right, I remember that.
He's really up
for it.
Yeah.
Uh oh.
That's a good sign.
That's great. You need to burn that. I don't know who brought that in.
So what happens?
So I think it exited.
Someone brought this before I throw this out?
Probably not.
What are you throwing out?
Sorry. I hate that shit.
Was it tape left around?
No.
No, it's the one that's like sort of harder. I'm a physicist.
Oh, well, Eric gave me that motion.
Do you want it?
I mean, it's been sitting on the table here for several days.
Let's see if it changed our skew whenever I tried to do that.
Okay.
I never saw that before.
What?
The max skew thing.
Oh.
Never ran into that.
I don't remember what the actual, like, quantitative thing it describes is. That's interesting that it's making them just a little bit more skewed than the max skew.
Right. Or
Huh.
I wonder what happens if we just hit OK. If it'll just do it anyways.
No, it'll just get angry.
Oh.
Alright, well,
max skew is a non-dimensional parameter ranging from 0 to 1. 1 is degenerate, 0 is ideal. The value is calculated by comparing the area or volume of the element that have an ideal element. Same.
That's all right. Yeah, it's wrong.
Okay, so we want lower skew.
I guess we could just abort the run if it doesn't meet quality criteria.
I kind of wonder what would happen if we bump it up and then don't remesh.
Like if I go to like 0.5 or to 1? It was at 0.99.
If you go to like 0.8 and then don't remesh but try and run it.
Well, that's what I was doing. I wasn't trying to remesh. I was just hitting OK. And then we go to case set, Y spin, run one.
Oh, so maybe it's just like finding the first one that violates the criteria.
Yeah, it's just doing a quality check. And if it violates the criteria, then it's getting angry. So I'm wondering if we just need to close that out. I've never seen that before.
Maybe this is a newer version.
Could be. Yeah, it fails it, like, barely. Something crazy, right?
Yeah.
I wonder if there's a way to like remesh it.
You just mesh part?
Well, it was over here. Oh, that's manual.
Why wouldn't it just be mesh parts?
Where?
Right there.
I think, like, you have to select the whole part to do that.
Ah.
I was looking for...
It's neat that it highlights the element down into the model.
Yeah.
Hey, green bulb.
Yes.
Oh, hey, Joe, man. Whose is this?
Why is it over there?
It might have been in someone's car and they brought it back and the other person forgot that they brought it back.
Okay, well, I'm going to do it here because I can hear it.
There's a note.
Really?
Yeah, the Blackboard show.
Oh, I'll take it.
What did you want to talk about? Or are you just asking me for
it? I just want to make sure that we're all cool for the next 48 hours. As we figure out what's going on and all that kind of stuff. And then you give me your mark.
I was going to work on really things, but I kind of want to delegate it. Yeah. Are you a good person to delegate it to?
It's totally mine.
Yes.
Okay.
No,
it's like really mine.
How do you?
It was
sorry. You are! What the hell? I guess I have somebody else's. Wait, no, 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 this is not mine. It just looks like mine.
Okay.
Okay, good. I was like, it's over here. Who's
sleeping in? You are sleeping in.
Yeah, ew. I mean, like, not that.
Oops.
Nurse, they're like, covered in.
Get your immunes up.
You took my motor.
Just me. Have you ever run FEA before?
No.
Okay.
I know that Joe has.
Joe has stepped out for a little bit.
That's part.
He just stepped out. So, I'm just trying to figure out why we're getting this bad elements error that keeps popping up so that we can't run it. It appears here. Actually, let me show you what I'm looking at because you can't see what I've been doing. You can see this?
Yeah.
Okay. So I've been looking at, like, trying to figure out why I can't, like, what's going on with the SKU and why it's throwing that error. It doesn't appear to like it. So it puts it into this bad elements category, right? So this is the manual that I got offline. Elements with a calculated SKU greater than this value be included in the bad elements group listing. And that's what I have here. So I have a list of elements that it has shown up as bad, which I think, to be perfectly honest, might be all of them. But I don't know how to go through and clear those. So any thoughts are appreciated. Yeah, it's does not like it for some reason. The last one they made. Yeah, and I'm in the same boat. You're looking at my level of FEA here. So values. Joe, we need your brain.
For Orset 5?
Yes, actually. That's what's going to Jupes.
No, Andrew's. I want to go to, like, Neptune.
No, that's too far.
So.
What about Venus?
That's fine.
Too hot. It's like Tucson.
Tucson's kind of nice.
So, Orset 5 is going to have, like, a deployable balloon. And I'm going to live in
That's okay. That's Orsat 3, though. Orsat 2 is my brain. Jupiter is higher.
I know.
Are we going to, like, gold plate your brain so it can deal with the radiation?
No, I'm going to just soak it up. That's going to be about Mars.
Okay, that's a good call. Yeah. So this is spitting out...
And that's how we made the Hulk around Jupiter.
So this is spitting out all of my elements that are bad into this bad LMs group listing. I literally think it's every element in here.
Oh, God.
And I don't know why it hates me. It's, like, all kinds. Maybe not all of them. But I don't know how to solve it.
Okay, I'm going to neglect you guys for a minute and send an email. Is that cool?
Yeah.
Okay. And...
Can I delete...